Right now, we're in the bowels of Te Papa, where there's this amazing collection of skeletons of all sorts of creatures from around the world, including moa. The giant moa gets all the sexy media and stuff, but we had them right down to this size. If you can see that skull there, this is one that was slightly larger than geese. Different species of moa had different shaped beaks, so that they had different ways and different techniques of pulling leaves and snipping through twigs. Unfortunately, all the moa are now gone. From the mid-1800s, the European settlers brought deer species from all around the world to Aotearoa, New Zealand, and set them free. They thought it was a way of helping create an equal society where anybody could go and hunt deer, not just aristocracy. They didn't know it, but they were unleashing an environmental disaster. Deer that were introduced here don't have natural predators like the countries that they came from, where they were hunted by panthers, wolves, and tigers. Deer eat in a completely different way to moa. They have a tongue that comes out and then wraps around vegetation and pulls it in, lips that nibble, and teeth that grind up that food. So they can eat entirely different types of things to what moa used to. Here we have a skull of the giant moa, the largest moa to have ever lived, and an average red deer skull. Look at the teeth at the front of that red deer and all the damage that they can do compared to the cutting part of the giant moa beak here at the front. The point is that moa are not deer and deer are not moa. Deer started to eat their way through the ecosystems from the ground, just as possums did from the tops of the native forests. Without their natural predators, deer populations explode. When deer first arrive in an area, they eat their favourite things first because most native plants have no way to defend themselves from introduced animals that eat plants. These red deer have been eating bark off native trees, which in time kills the tree. Deer have special stomachs that can extract energy from bark, from seedlings, and from leaf litter. In forests with heaps of deer, they're really hungry, and so they've even eaten all the leaf litter. And so that makes the forest far less drought resistant. Deer, goats, pigs, and wallabies eat the forest from the bottom up, while the possums eat the forest from the top down. Bit by bit, over years and decades, the forest's natural food web falls apart, and natural forest regeneration is undermined by the scoffing mammals. Some native species become rarer and rarer in these areas. Some disappear. These are local extinction events, like the disappearance of northern rata in the southern Ruaheni ranges. Some of our greatest carbon sinks, the native forests, turn into carbon emitters as the ancient trees killed by possums and deer die and release carbon dioxide as they rot away. Future forests and carbon sinks are under attack too, as the tree seedlings get eaten before they can become trees, leaving not much surviving on the forest floor. If deer were in this forest, the seedlings around me would have already been eaten, including the rongoā species, and they would have prevented the regeneration and replacement going on here. We need to seriously reduce or eliminate possums, deer, and other browsing animals in native forests so that the native forest can again return to being one of the best carbon sinks on land.